Got on the Move.
Hey, Cale, did you talk to Jesus about what I said? And she dropped her head. I mean, she just dropped her head for a second. And I said, well, did you? And then she looked up and she had tears in her eyes. She shook her head yes. And she said, yeah, I asked him if he would talk to you. And he said he does, but you don't listen.
Family medicine is a medical specialty within primary care that provides continuing and comprehensive health care for the individual and family across all ages, genders, diseases, and parts of the body. In many countries, these specialists are referred to as family doctors or GP, short for general practitioner. For millions around the world, these doctors are the first point of contact for any medical question or concern, from the early stages of pregnancy all the way to the last days of one's life. In Luke 5, Jesus himself referred to him as a physician who comes to call the sinners to repentance. For it is not those who are well who need a physician, but those who are sick. You are listening to God on the Move, a Lausanne Movement production. And this is a story about a faith-driven medical journey. The voice you heard earlier is Walt Larimore. He's a family physician, educator, author, and medical journalist. And this is his story.
My name is Walt Larimore. I live in the United States in Colorado in the Rocky Mountains. And I self-identify and have for over 50 years as a follower of Jesus. I'm a husband. I've been married to my childhood sweetheart for over 50 years. We met when we were 5 years old in what's called kindergarten here. It's preschool. And we met in a sandbox when we were 5 years of age. And so I married my childhood sweetheart. And Barb has been my wife for over 50 years, my best friend for over 65 years. We have 6 children, 2 adult children who are married, and people will often ask me how many grandchildren I have, and I say, not enough. But we have 2 precious granddaughters, and we have 4 children who are in heaven. We had our first 2 children, and then our last 4 were lost in the middle of pregnancy. It was a difficult time in our life when that happened. We both grew up in the south of the United States in a state called Louisiana. So we have some French blood in our background and some English blood in our background. Barb and I both met Jesus when we were studying undergraduate at Louisiana State University. In Louisiana, we call it LSU or Harvard on the Bayou. Jokingly, my wife's mom and dad were teachers. My mom was a nurse and my father was a cartographer, a map maker. My dad and Barb's dad were both professors at LSU. After undergraduate school, I went to medical school and then Barb put me through school. She was a teacher. And then we were overseas in England for a Queen's Fellowship and spent the better part of a year in England and North Africa and the Middle East and Europe studying. And then came back to the United States and I did postgraduate studies in family medicine and sports medicine, and then began the practice of family medicine, took care of patients from conception to cremation through their whole life, initially in the Smoky Mountains of Western North Carolina, the United States, and then down into the Central Florida area, where I was a professor. I had a family medicine practice, but also a sports medicine practice, served as a U.S. Olympic physician, and as a researcher, publishing, and as a writer and teacher. Teaching medical students and family medicine residents. And then towards the end of the century, Barb and I were called to a ministry here in Colorado called Focus on the Family. So I was the vice president of Focus on the Family under Dr. James Dobson for a number of years. And then that ministry went through a leadership change. And so in about 2008, left Focus on the Family, and my wife and I ran a ministry, a mission medical clinic here in Colorado Springs. And I did that for about 10 years, taking care of the poorest of the poor, immigrants, refugees, having both a medical practice, but also learning how to do ministry in medicine. And during that time, became a writer. I've published 40 books and over 1,200 articles. And then just recently, last December, stepped away from patient care. And my wife and I direct a marriage ministry at a local church. So that's kind of a Cliff Notes version of some of the paths the Lord has taken us on.
I was so intrigued by Walt's story and everything that he does that I didn't even know where to start. So I figured the best start is to start right at the beginning. And I asked him, what made him want to become a family doctor?
I never saw myself as a physician. I never thought it was possible. I didn't think I was that smart or had the connections or whatever. I was attracted to medical caring, not medical care, but medical caring by my mom. She was a nurse and she was a full-time mom, but she would work a Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, the 3 o'clock to the 11 p.m. shifts. My dad was a graduate student, so she helped earn income for our family of four boys. And so when she would get home at 11 o'clock at the night on Friday, Saturday, Sunday, she would come wake me up and sit on my bed and we would talk a few moments and she would tell me, she was a nurse on the maternity unit, the obstetrics unit, and she would tell me about all the babies that she had delivered and all of the women that she took care of. And so I was very attracted by her vision and her passion for caring, just really caring for people. I also saw that in some childhood incidences. I had my tonsils removed when I was a little boy and one of the ligatures broke loose and I was hemorrhaging, literally hemorrhaging to death. And to watch her care for me, I mean, saved my life as I was bleeding out. Another time, my friends and I were playing soldiers back in the woods and I got captured as a prisoner of war. And then when I escaped, one of my captors said, "Stop or I'll shoot." And I kept running and he threw a knife at me and it went through my leg and so I ruptured an artery. And so they hauled me back to the house and there my mom has to tell me, "None of my boys are dying on my shift," you know, and taking me to the hospital. So I had this real fondness. I had some medical mentors, parents, fathers of other children who were physicians. So I deeply admired their compassion and their caring. But it wasn't until Barb and I were officially dating. We didn't start dating until high school. And her father, who had been an Air Force pilot and a professor, told me that if I was going to have any interest in marrying his daughter, that I would either have to go into the military or into law or be a professor or be a doctor. And I said, "Well, I don't think I have the smarts to be a doctor." And he said, "Walt, I think you do." I was studying marine biology at that time, and the curriculum was identical to pre-med. And so I just switched to pre-med. It sounded cool, and it attracted the girls. But I just didn't think I would get into medical school. But to appease my father-in-law, I applied to medical school, but I also applied with a ministry to be a missionary. I really felt the Lord was calling me into mission work. And I also thought I might need to have some theological training. And so I applied to a seminary. So medical school, seminary, and missions work. And the mission organization turned us down. Didn't know why. They just said, "No, we're not interested in you." And I never heard from the seminary. And then I got accepted to medical school. It was the strangest thing. And so I thought to myself, "Lord, what are you doing? Why?" And the answer I thought in my mind was, maybe I'm just going to go to medical school for a couple of years, learn some first aid, and then I'll go to the mission field. And while I'm in medical school, I can take some seminary courses at a seminary in New Orleans, Louisiana, which I did. And it was there in medical school that I actually fell in love with medicine and was attracted to being a medical missionary in medicine. And there was a man who was a mentor of mine. He'd been a Catholic priest, had then become an alcoholic, had left the priesthood and was working in the Ninth Ward, which is a very poor area of New Orleans. Some of our listeners may know the name is Brennan Manning. And so I had the opportunity to study and work with Brennan Manning for 2 years and to be able to see grace in action, to be able to see forgiveness in the flesh, to be able to see caring at the deepest level with Brennan Manning was deeply, deeply powerful. At the same time, a British physician who was married to a British physician who had served on the mission, medical mission field in India for several decades, a man and woman who took care of lepers in India. At one time, it was said that Dr. Paul Brand had 15 million patients, leper patients in India that he took care of. But he and his wife were getting older, and so Dr. Paul Brand, Sir Paul Brand, he was a member of the Order of the British Empire, OBE, but they had been brought to Louisiana to head the public health hospital for lepers in Carville, Louisiana, just upriver from New Orleans where I was studying. So I had this expressively wonderful mentorship with Dr. Paul Brand and with Brennan Manning. And after medical school overseas for the Queen's Fellowship, and they're having the opportunity to worship and learn from Pastor John Stott in London. It just became a deep, wonderful opportunity. And then learning how to work with his church and ministering to the poor in London while we were studying, and then the poor up in Nottingham. And so it just was woven into the fabric of who I was. Wherever we practiced for every level of society. And about the pride of Americans, I'll confess to you, I think I was raised with that same spirit, you know, can do, will do, pick up your pants and move on. on, you pick yourself up. But once I began to take care of people who were down and out, and once I began to study how Jesus dealt with people at all levels of society and all genders and all backgrounds, and then to see how despicable some of those circumstances were, and it literally could be impossible to pick yourself up. And so a deep love, I do it a long answer to a short question, but it was just like God's Holy Spirit gave me this sense of being able to look at people and to weep not only for them, but with them, to be with them, to walk with them, to help them when I could, and maybe even more importantly, to see how miraculously they could help me as we co-journeyed into this path that had been brought together, in this case, by my medical practice.
Much of what he shared deeply resonated with me. It brought back many memories of experiences when I felt rather uncomfortable in my own context. Whether a cultural setting, a national identity of a particular country, or even a more local expression of such, can feel and oftentimes is diametrically opposing to the way Jesus calls us to live. I was interested to hear Walt's view on this.
That there are people listening to us around the world who feel uncomfortable in the culture where they are. And my encouragement to myself and to them is, I think that can be God-given, that we are strangers. We are not citizens here. We're citizens in another kingdom. But we've been called here, and we've not been called to comfort. We've been called to be uncomfortable because we have a different anchor, a different hope, a different home. But we've been given a job as ambassadors, and we've been given the ministry of reconciliation into whatever profession or whatever job or whatever culture or whatever neighborhood. And the lack of comfort, I think, can be a good thing. That our comfort, our peace, our joy, our love, our goodness, our love, joy, peace, patience, our kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control should rest not in the culture, not in the country, and not in mammon, but in the Holy Spirit who works in us and through us. And so early on in my career, predominantly in this case because of Dr. Brand's teaching as a doctor who took care of deeply damaged, physically damaged, and emotionally and mentally damaged patients suffering from leprosy, but to be able to enter their reality as an ambassador of the King and to find out where they were in their spiritual journey, wherever that would be, and not to pull them or push them in any direction, but rather to find out where they were, to love them right there, to serve them, which is a way of serving our King also, and then asking God, in my case, on a patient-by-patient basis, Father, what are you doing here? I need to find that out. What are you doing here, and how can I join you? It's not me and my ministry. It's me joining you at work in your ministry. And that revolutionized my entire professional career in learning how, over time, and often over great periods of time, to walk with people as God draws them to himself.
The question, Father, what are you doing here, reminded me of a conversation I had just days prior, recording a future episode. Our guest shared the story of a missionary coming to China. Among the many, many missionaries that come to his country, this one stood out to him because he didn't come with an agenda, but he came simply to serve. And it made me wonder what Walt's experience has been like caring for patients. How does he experience God in that?
Someone challenged me recently to do some math, and I think I've seen well over 100,000 patients in the last 50 years of practice. And my challenge early in medicine, Jesus both healed the sick and preached the kingdom. And then when he sent the disciples out on their first missionary journeys, two by two, he sent them to heal the sick and preach the kingdom. Those are ands, not ors. And so from a very early stage, I had to figure out how do you bring Jesus with you to work? How do you bring him with you to the neighborhood? How do you bring him with you in relationships? And especially, Jesus didn't just weep over Jerusalem, but he walked in and he sat down and he talked and he listened and he asked questions and he dined with people. In fact, just in the book of Luke, there's over 10 instances of Jesus just sitting down and talking with people. There was an evangelistic movement when I was in school. I would call it confrontational evangelism. It would teach students that you should ask diagnostic questions. Find out where someone was. The most important thing was getting them to make a decision for Christ, was persuading them to pray a prayer. And really nothing else mattered. And I rebelled against that. That seemed to me to be anathema. That seemed to me to be anti-Jesus. Not that he didn't want them in the kingdom, but instead of forcing or pushing or pulling them to where he was, he met them where they were. His ministry was founded first and foremost on large amounts of prayer, large amount of talking with his father and listening to his father. In fact, I saw a sign recently at a retreat facility for where people go for silent retreats. And when you walk in the reception area, there's a big framed sign, and it has the word silent, S-I-L-E-N-T in English. And then below that has the word listen, L-I-S-T-E-N. And then in smaller print, it says the word silent and the word listen have the same exact letters. Is that a coincidence? And so early on, my mind is not one that's comfortable with silence. It's not comfortable with quiet time. I think I might have a little attention deficit disorder. And so it's been difficult for me to listen. I love the transfiguration that is talked about in the book of Mark, where God says of his son Jesus, after Elijah and Moses disappear and Jesus is there with the three disciples, and God says, "This is my son. Listen to him." It's a powerful life verse for me, is to learn to listen to the Father.
Before we continue with the story, I want to let you know that we want to share gospel stories from the Global Church with the Global Church. So if you have a story to share or know someone who might have, please contact us at podcast@lausanne.org. That is podcast@lausanne.org. We would also appreciate your feedback on God on the Move, as this will help us improve our podcast to the audience. You can find the link in the podcast description.
I'll tell you a brief, very sad story. Our oldest daughter has cerebral palsy. So she had a stroke when she was in the womb. And she was born with very little right brain and about half of a left brain. So quite handicapped. But yet she learned to walk. She learned to talk. She's brilliant. She's learned to deal with her handicaps. She calls them not disabled, she's other abled. A very confident young lady, but she absolutely loves Jesus. And I found through my career that handicapped children, mentally deficient children, children with terminal disease have a marvelous ability to see Jesus and to hear him and to see angels and to hear them. And I've had multiple patients who have had those experiences. But Kate hears Jesus. She talks to him. He talks to her. And so as a young girl, I was frustrated that she could hear him and I couldn't. Her name's Kate Larimore, and I call her Kate-L, K-L, Kate-L. But one day I said, "Kate, do you think you could talk to the Lord and just ask him if he would say something to me?" Even no, but can you imagine hearing the Lord's voice? And she said, "Oh yeah, Daddy, no problem, I'll do it." And after a few days, we were sharing a meal together and I said, "Hey, Kate, did you talk to Jesus about what I said?" And she dropped her head. I mean, she just dropped her head for a second. And I said, "Well, did you?" And then she looked up and she had tears in her eyes. She shook her head yes, and she said, "Yeah, I asked him if he would talk to you, and he said he does, but you don't listen." And it was a powerful convictor for me early in my professional life that I needed to learn how to listen. Now, for me, with attention deficit, that means I can't just be quiet. So I've learned to use scripture, both to listen to the word, the voice, the whispers of God, and then also to speak prayer to him. And so my daily time is to systematically read scripture, listening to not just reading words I've read hundreds and hundreds of times, but reading to listen to a new voice. And so that's my listening time for God. And in my prayer time, I will usually pray scripture back to him. I love praying through Proverbs and Psalms. My discipline is, so today when we're recording, it's the 13th of the month. And so I will read a section of New Testament scripture to listen. I'll read the 13th proverb today to listen. And then I start at the 13th Psalm and just add 30 days a month on average. So I read in Psalm 13, 33, 63, 93, 123. It doesn't take very long at all. So my prayer time is praying Proverbs and Psalms. And that to me has become the foundation of any sort of ministry that I have in my profession. I cannot not listen and talk to God. So that's the foundation. The second step then is to move into the world seeking first the kingdom of God. Intentionally saying, "God, what are you doing? If you're in charge, if you're sovereign," and he is, then today is no accident. you are not depressed by what's going on in culture. You, Father, are not on an antidepressant. You've got this. The final chapter has been written. It's just playing out. And no matter what I decide, whether I decide to serve you today or not, you are going to call your people. In fact, no one will come to you that you don't first call, Jesus said. No one comes to the Father until the Father calls. And Jesus said, if I'm lifted up before people, I will draw them to myself. So he's already at work. He doesn't need me, but he asked me to join him in his work of calling his people to himself. And so to walk into the day just asking the question, what are you doing? God, what are you doing? In fact, early in my first practice, my nurse took a little 3x5 card and she wrote on it, WIGD. And it was on each little chart rack outside the room where I would see patients. And it meant, what is God doing? So to walk into that room, and God may not be doing anything. That's okay. I'm still called to do everything as unto the Lord. So I'm called to be the best doctor I can be. I'm called to be compassionate. I'm called to have competence. That's critical. I'm called to be the best physician this patient's ever seen. And I'm called to do good, evidence-based, quality care. That's the highest form of worship, to do everything as unto the Lord. But with my spiritual antenna saying, what's God doing here? What's God doing here? And so salt, to me, is speaking God's word. Light is living God's word, being an excellent doctor. And then salt is just salting my conversation. I like calling it faith flags. So I might say to a patient, this is going to be a tough decision. I'm one who believes in prayer. And so between now and the next time I see you, would you mind if I prayed about that decision for you? Or I might pray with the patient. In medicine, we are taught to do a spiritual history. When we do a social history, we find out where someone works and their family history and whether they smoke or use alcohol or other drugs or whatever's going on socially with them. It's just to ask some spiritual questions. I always ask the God questions. It's an English acrostic G-O-D, and the G is God or faith or prayer, something that's important to you or not. I'm not judging, I'm just interested. And the O, the G is God, the O is others. Are you now or have you ever been part of a spiritual community, a faith community? And if so, what did it mean to you or what does it mean to you? And then the D, so G is God, O is others, and the D is what can I do, if anything, to meet you in your spiritual journey. And so I started off saying that so many of gifted evangelists, these are people that literally will go sit on a plane and always sit in the middle seat because they've got a person on each side of them that they can share with. And they've got three in front of them and three behind them. And by the time the plane lands, five of them pray to receive Christ. This is gifted evangelism. And Paul tells us in Ephesians 4, 11 and 12, that God only gave some as evangelists. And I'm not one. Most of us are not evangelists. And I find that Christians and non-Christians have one thing in common. They hate evangelism. In other words, they hate that beating me over the head with a Bible thing. That just is anathema. In fact, it actually, I think, chases people away. But to love them and meet them where they're at, to serve them with all that you can serve them with, is the highest, as Brendan Manning would say, the highest form of worship. So Jesus did not describe his ministry as a harvesting ministry. He didn't keep account of how many people came into the kingdom and how many people he baptized and how much money he raised. But he described his ministry as in agrarian terms. He talked about cultivating. He talked about sowing and watering and weeding. And he talked about harvesting and he talked about multiplication. But I've come to think of it this way. Cultivation is meeting people where they're at, and its goal is being present. Its goal is not that they trust Jesus or not that they trust the Bible. It's that they trust a Christian because they've met Christians often who have misrepresented the kingdom, God and misrepresented his love. And so just to interact with them, just to have them smell that sweet aroma of love and joy and peace, to be able to testify to ways in telling faith stories, if there's an area where a patient or a friend or a neighbor is wrestling, and God's done something in my life or my family's life or another patient's life, to be able to share that as a faith story, not demanding a response, but just introduce, letting them know that this door of faith is open at our house. I'm open to talk about it, and I'm not going to push anything on you. I just want to find out where God is, and if the Holy Spirit's at work, I'm going to fan that flame a little. That's cultivation. And then if you cultivate enough relationships with kindness and gentleness and faithfulness and faith stories and faith flags, when appropriate, people are going to begin to ask questions. And that's an opportunity then to share God's word. You've got to know it first. You have to have memorized portions of it to be able to share from the heart what God says. But the Apostle Peter, St. Peter, I see him as a very brash, very bold disciple, foot in the mouth kind of guy, but never afraid to speak, right? And even deny Christ, not afraid to deny, but very bold. He says something very powerful to me. It's in 1 Peter chapter 3, I think verse 15. He says to all of us who are followers of Jesus, he says, be prepared always to make a defense of the faith that lies within you. Now, I heard that preached and taught with that sentence ending there. Be prepared always to make a defense of the faith that lies within you. And people that teach that would say, every person you meet, everyone you talk to, you need to present the gospel. You need to defend your faith. You need to be an apologist. But that's not what Peter said. Peter said, be prepared always to make a defense for the faith that lies within you when asked. His words, not mine. When asked. And then, when asked, and then with gentleness and reverence. So two questions for all of us is, are people asking about your faith? Because if they are not, then my diagnosis is your light is under a bushel basket, you're hiding your light, and your salt isn't salty enough. If they're not asking, you've not been salt and light. And it's not every day, it's not every person, but that's the diagnostic question. But when they ask, it's not to jump on them. It's not to pull out a gospel tract. It's not to persuade them to pray a prayer, but with gentleness and reverence. And I see that Greek word for gentleness is almost like a mother breastfeeding a baby. It's extremely intimate to give that baby the milk that it needs to grow and to live and to survive and to thrive. And a mother does that with deep love and deep intimacy, with touch, with loving touch. Peter says that when someone asks, be gentle, and with reverence. You're entering the Holy of Holies. You are an ambassador. You are a representative of the King of the universe. And you're giving an opportunity to share how that King has changed your life or your family's life. And you're not responsible for the results. I tell the students I teach that you enter into your work in the power of the Holy Spirit, but you leave the results to God. Because surveys have shown that the average adult convert, almost irrespective of culture, can name between 9 and 24 significant relationships or significant moments that touch their journey to coming to know Christ. And so I think it's freeing to know that I don't have to be all 24. I can just be me. And that interaction may take seconds. It may take a minute or two. And it's intentional, but it's not overwork. It's overflow. It's allowing him to slosh out on those you see in the power of the Holy Spirit, leaving the result to God. I hope it helps frame the excitement that you can have moving into each day to see what God's doing and to join him in his work and in his ministry.
As always, there is so much more to say. I had the privilege to speak to Walt again without recording and just listen to more of his wisdom and deeply inspiring stories. But as we end, I wanted to dig a bit deeper and get a better understanding of what Walt was saying. We all use words, sayings and phrases that are particular to a certain context or community and make perfect sense to everyone within that particular setting. In our evangelical Christianese, we often hear things like, just turn your eyes towards Jesus. Yet, he's pretty much invisible, at least for the time being. Or, just listen to what God tells you. From my own experience, but also from people I know, especially non-Christians, these phrases mean absolutely nothing. So, to wrap it up, my question was, how does someone listen to God? And here is what, one last time.
I can imagine most everyone, if not everyone, has wrestled with that. Here in America and perhaps many cultures, God is sometimes seen as a vending machine. And there's all sorts of treats, all sorts of answers in that machine. And if I just have the right coin and I put it in the right way, God will respond in a predictable fashion. And it's the exact opposite of what Scripture teaches. God is not our servant. He is not our go-to boy. He's not our all-giving father who gives whatever we ask, whenever we ask. And so to be able to give him the permission to be quiet, to be able to give him the permission to not speak, to be able to trust him enough to wait, but to do that in an attitude and in an atmosphere that allows us to hear. So for me, a couple powerful ways that happens. One I've already talked about is just to camp in his word without an agenda. Although I remember early when I first came to trust him as my Lord and Savior, the man, my spirit spiritual dad who was guiding me through that process and answering my questions had indicated that I should, when I was ready, I could ask Christ to come into my life, and he would come in and he would live with me and he would dine with me. And so one night I did. I just went into my dorm room and I locked the door and I prayed that prayer. I said, Father, I don't know if you're here, God, or not, but if you are, I want to know you. I want you to come live with me and dine with me, and I want to walk with you. And you know what happened? Nothing. I mean, angels didn't sing and lights didn't go off. There were no fireworks. I just was in a dark room. I went to sleep and I woke up the next morning and went down for breakfast. And it was same old me, same scuzzy hair and hadn't showered yet and was having breakfast. And Rich, my spiritual dad, walked in and we were talking. I told him I'd made a decision and he got real excited about that. And I said, but I don't feel any different. And he said, well, what did you expect? And I said, I don't know, but I expected something. And he said, Walt, I can tell you this. The God that now lives in you is not a father of lies. He does not tell untruths. And he says in his word that if you ask him in, he will come in. And I can tell you, based upon God's word, that he's there. And let me tell you two ways that you'll begin to see him at work. One is to begin to read his love letter to you every day. The Bible was written to you specifically for you. God wants to speak through that. And so you need to go every day into God's word. And also begin to be on the lookout for how he changes you, how your thoughts change and your behaviors change, and expect people to respond to that, to notice a difference. And so I said, okay, where do I start? He says, I'd recommend you go to John every day and read a little bit. And you know what I said? I said, why do I have to go to the bathroom to read the Bible? Because I thought he said, go to the John, you know, not to the book of John. I wasn't very theologically advanced. He said, no. There's this book called the book of John and just read. Now, I had, as a child, as a young man, had tried to read through the Bible two or three times, front to back, couldn't make head or tails of it. It just made no sense to me at all. But when I started reading the book of John, it sang to me. And so just to rehash that he can and will speak to you through his word if you're listening. But the second key for me is to be able to get away, to get outside, to get into nature. Some of the medical researchers call it forest bathing. But the book of Romans tells us that God's immeasurable power and his omniscience and his omnipresence speaks through nature. And it's not unusual in nature to hear people see a natural event and go, oh my God, Jesus did this. He left exam rooms that were completely packed with people. And he just left. He had to have time with his Father. And so many of us are wrapped up in so much activity and our schedules are so crammed that we miss him by not spending time with him. Time in which we're allowing him to be silent, but time in which we're expecting him to speak. When Kate was six, our daughter was six, I was working pretty hard. I was working about 100 hours a week because I was teaching medical students in residence. I was writing at that time. I was seeing patients as a practitioner in the hospital and home visits and doing sports medicine. So I was busy. And so on Kate's sixth birthday, man, my dad called. And he talked to Kate, and she loved my dad. And then afterwards, he asked her to put me on the phone. So I got on the phone and said, hey, Dad. He said, well, congratulations, Walt. And I said, for what? I thought maybe I'd done something he was proud of. And he said, oh, Kate's birthday. It means that one third of your life with her is over. And it took about a millisecond to realize that he was telling me she's six, but when she's 18, she'll be gone. And what are you investing in? What are you investing in? And God blessed me to meet a man named Richard Swinson. He's a family physician in the northern United States in Wisconsin. And he had written a book called Margin, which was how do you develop margin in your finances, in your time, in your possessions, and even in your time with God? How do you prioritize what's eternally important? How do you seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness? Because that seeking is what everything else of meaning is attached to. I heard John Stott in London once said, as a follower of Jesus, you're either a missionary or you're a mission field. It's your choice, but you're one or the other. But as an everyday missionary, wherever you live, however horrible the culture is to first and foremost that foundation of prayer, to pray without ceasing. In every situation, by prayer and supplication, make your requests known to God. And then the peace peace of God, which passes all understanding, will guard your hearts and mind in Christ Jesus. Rejoice always. Give thanks in all things. Pray without ceasing, for this is the will of God for you. And so upon that foundation, to begin intentionally seeking first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And he's clothed you with his righteousness. So enjoy, revel in that cloak, but seek. And it may involve changing some priorities. It may involve changing your schedule. And then on that foundation, put being salt and light. And that's cultivating relationships where people come to trust not Christ, but you. And when asked, and when appropriate, to sow the word of God into that. Because in most cultures, people are interested in what Scripture has to say. Not about the Trinity, not about super-infralapsarianism. What they're interested in is, what wisdom is there for what I'm wrestling with? A divorce, or a relationship, or a job, or a financial situation, or an illness. Does God have anything to say to me? And so in sowing, people don't come to trust Jesus, but they come to trust God's word for where they're hurting. And then there's that final harvest stage, that stage of making a decision. Will they marry this person that wants to have a relationship with them for eternity? And we get to be spectators to that process and all the people that God runs us into. Some of them we may see only seconds a day, some we may see longer. But to approach that day with a looking and listening. So looking, God, what are you doing? And then listening to that still voice. And what I've found is the more that I intentionally listen, the more I hear. And the way that he spoke to me miraculously, that he was always there. We lost 4 children to miscarriage. And our children were lost in the middle of pregnancy. So they were quite formed and quite recognizable. They were little babies, just tiny little babies. And each baby, each loss was more painful, almost exponentially. And the last one was horribly difficult. Barb lost the baby in the hospital and had to spend the night. And I was really angry with God. There were so many women I ran into that wanted to kill their unborn babies. And we wanted nothing but a big family. We felt we wanted to have a big, big family. And we kept hearing no, no, no. And then a final no. And I went home and just sat down. I had a chair that was my quiet time chair, kind of a little real comfortable chair that I would sit in. And I was sitting in that chair and I was just fussing at the Lord. I was arguing with him. I was letting him know my discomfort with what he either caused or allowed. A refusal to answer my prayer in Jesus' name for this child. I don't think I heard him, but I wondered if he was saying, my own son prayed to remove this cup, but your will be done. I didn't hear that part, Walt. But anyway, I fought him. I was so angry. And I finally fell back into that chair. And when I did, I felt that I wasn't sitting in a chair, but I was sitting in a lap. I felt a feeling like arms wrapping around me. I couldn't move. I didn't move. But I felt like I was in God's embrace. I felt like I was in his lap. And then I had water hit my nose. I thought, well, that's a funny place for a tear. It was the roof leaking, and I looked up and there was nothing, but I wiped this. And I thought, I guess my tears went sideways. But I knew he was there. I knew it. In my heart of hearts. I knew that God collected my tears in a bottle and that he loved me. I knew that he was good. I knew he was just. I knew he was right. And I was willing to commit to that even in the midst of this horror I was going through. About 2 years later, I was taking care of a little boy, a preteen boy. He was a wonderful athlete, all-state in baseball and football, but a wonderful follower of Jesus. This kid absolutely loved the Lord. He taught Sunday school. He was a little evangelist. He led classmates to Christ, but he was pitching one day, and when he pitched, there was this loud pop, and he fell to the pitcher's mound, writhing in pain, and they brought him over to the emergency room where I took care of him, and his humerus, his arm bone, had broken, and the x-ray showed not just the fracture, but that there was cancer, that he had had cancer that had eaten away the bone, and that had caused the fracture. And it was a type of cancer that was not treatable in those days, so he had an amputation. He lost his right arm, he was right-handed, and he lost his athletic future. And I watched this kid grow more deeply in love with God. Despite this handicap, he just grew in his relationship with the Lord, and he became a young mentor of mine. Unfortunately, the cancer came back and it metastasized through his body. And then he was in hospice care and I would go visit his home. And last time I saw him, he was in his bed and he was in coma at that time. Most of the time, he was on a morphine drip to help with pain and breathing. But I was sitting by him, holding his hand and just praying for him. And he gripped my hand and I looked up and his eyes were open. And I was so happy to be able to talk to him. And so I said, are you comfortable? And he said, yeah, I am comfortable. And not just physically, but I'm comfortable because I know I'm going to heaven. I know I'm going to see Jesus, and I know I'm going to hear his voice. I know that. And I was astounded by that confidence and challenged it. And I said, how do you know that? And he said, my angel told me. I said, you're what? He said, yeah, God has given me an angel. He has a name. He has long hair. He carries a big sword. He's even let me hold the sword. And he told me that he will carry me to heaven and that I do not have to be afraid. And I was astounded. And quite frankly, wondering if it was the morphine or hallucination or what. And I said, how do you know? How do you know it's real? And he said, you should know. And I said, how should I know? And he said, he is your guardian angel. And he is your family's guardian angel. And he took each of your babies to heaven. Now I was getting really worried about the morphine. I mean, he took each of my babies to heaven. How do you know that? He said, he told me. And then he told me that he came to your house and you were angry. And so he just held you and he held you in his arms and his tears fell on you. Nobody knew that story. Barb didn't know that story. Kate didn't know that story. Scott didn't. No one knew that story. No one knew that story. But this special little boy did. I think that when I get to heaven, I'm going to learn things God did that I had no idea he did. Things that he did in me that I had no idea he was doing. Things that he's done through me that I have no idea. Because if I knew what he was doing through me, I think I'd probably get the big head and wanted to take credit for it. But brothers and sisters, he loves us so deeply and widely. Unimaginable love. He's called us. He's elected us. He's adopted us. He sent his son to die for us. Excruciating death. And he's given us his Holy Spirit to teach us, convict us, to draw us, to comfort us. So how do we flesh that out? There's no formula. It's different each day. His compassions come each day, but they're different each day. And so rather than seeking a formula for how do you do this, to ask him, Father, how should I do this? What do you have for me? I'm willing to listen. I'll take time to listen, but I'll give you freedom to be quiet until I can hear. And to be willing to let him shine, to do the good works that he's called us to before time. But those are good works that we do in his name, in confidence, so that people may see our good works and not glorify us, but glorify God in heaven. As you wrestle with this new culture and new work and new house and new neighborhood, to bathe it in prayer, founded on intentionally seeking first the kingdom of God, being salt that is infinitely flavorful, not saltless, because that's thrown out, not too salty, because that's damaging, but how do you be salt in the right concentration, and light that's attractive. I took my little boy, I date my children. When I was a parent, I would date them. And so I would take them out. And I took Scott once to a hamburger place and we had burgers and he took the bun off his hamburger and took the salt shaker and was going to sprinkle a little salt on it. And some fool had loosened the top of the salt. So the whole salt shaker came out. And some people are that way spiritually. They don't want to be flavorful. They're going to be the whole flipping salt shaker. Don't do that. Just be flavorful salt. And when I turned 40 some time ago, my eyes turned 40. And so I had to go see the eye doctor and he did an exam called direct ophthalmoscopy where they dilate your pupils and then they take this Star Wars laser beam and shine it into your eye. And when he shined that light, it was nauseatingly painful. And it reminded me that we can be nauseatingly painful in our testimony sometimes. But can our house, can our home, can our apartment, can our desk at work, can it be a lighthouse? Not a spotlight, but a lighthouse where people feel warm and accepted and loved. I think of people coming to Christ as being on a journey that's many, many steps. M-A-N-Y-M-I-N-I. And if my interaction with them would just help them take the next little step in their journey, whether it's a story that I tell, people love stories, whether it's a question that I ask, not to catch them, but to learn about them, to find out where they're at, to join them there by serving them, loving them, in the power of the Holy Spirit, leaving the results to God. Life becomes fun, exhilarating. It doesn't mean you don't have persecution. It doesn't mean you don't have troubles. Jesus said, you will have trouble, but I will be with you. I'll be with you. And the closest that any of us are to hell is where we are today. And so to join our fellow human beings in loving them and serving them in the power of the Holy Spirit and leave the result to God.
You've listened to God on the Move, Lausanne Movement podcast, where we want to listen to mission stories from the global church. Through listening to what God is doing around the world, we hope to encourage and challenge the global church to faithful obedience to the Great Commission. So let's accelerate global mission together toward a vision for the gospel for every person, disciple-making churches for every people and place, Christ-like leaders in every church and sector, and kingdom impact in every sphere of society. If you enjoyed listening to this episode, be sure to subscribe and follow us for more.